No, they only supposed to represent greed, hatred and delusion. And it's only a
story. To clarify that, otherwise some of us think, you know, either they, because some of these fables got the white snake and all this, are these also devas or asuras, for instance?
Oh, snakes are under these nagas. Nagas, a madam white snake came down from heaven. So these are nagas under the four great heavenly kings. In fact, devas are not all as happy as you think, because the lower devas, like these nagas, snake spirits, and Garuda, the bird spirits, and even the yakas, they have to kill to survive. They have to kill to eat. So they also have to cari makan. But they don't have to work like us, lah. So it's not all that pleasant there, lah.
Any other queries anywhere? Oh, right at the back. A mic over there, please. Thank you. Yeah.
Bhante. In the suttas, it was mentioned that the Mahabrahma is in the Brahma realm. This is what the Hindu believe. If I beg your indulgence, what about the God that the Christians, the Hindus, and the Jews that they pray to? Where would you classify them? Thank you.
They are not in the Buddhist cosmology. It's dangerous to say more.
Any other queries? Oh, over there, yeah.
If one person were to cultivate samatha deep enough, does it lead to jhana state?
If he's practicing the right concentration.
Is it limited to in-breath and out-breath observation?
No. You can practice anything as long as you focus on one object, rupa, you get rupa jhana.
Don't understand what's rupa jhana.
Rupa is a form. For example, the body is a form. But there are some meditations, they are, for example, Tibetan Buddhism, they practice visualization. They look at a picture of a Dharma protector. They have two types. One is a fierce spirit, fierce being, for those who have a lot of lust. And then for those who have a lot of anger, they focus on Tara, something like Kuan Yin. So they look at that picture and they close their eyes, open, look and close their eyes. They keep doing that for thousands of times. And then that picture forms in their mind. And then when they close their eyes so they can see. But that type of meditation is a bit dangerous. Because sometimes if they don't have a teacher by their side, a competent teacher, and they don't want to see, the form appears. It follows them and they get frightened out of their wits. That doesn't seem to be an object like the breath. The Buddha's Anapanasati, if you study the suttas, when you notice your breath going in and out, You're supposed to notice your whole body also, aware of your whole body. Because when we notice our whole body, we are in the here and now. Otherwise, the tendency of the mind to run away is very strong. So whenever we are aware of our body, we come back to here and now. So for example, if you read the biography of the founder of Dhammakaya in Thailand, it was a Mechi, a nun, and she explained her meditation in that biography. She said their meditation is to imagine a crystal in your body. So they keep thinking of that crystal in the body until it sticks in their mind. And then you make it bright. Then that crystal in the body becomes brighter and brighter and brighter. Then she said, she looked into the center of the crystal, which is the brightest spot, and she entered that crystal. And when she entered that brightest spot, she entered the Dhammakaya. And then she said, she could go astral traveling. Then she went to look for her father who had passed away. And she found her father in hell, very miserable looking and very thin and all that. So she told her father, today you're in hell because last time you used to slaughter animals and all that. So she told her father, now you must keep your sila. Remember to keep your sila and I will teach you meditation. So she taught the father meditation, and slowly the father's body became more and more beautiful. And then she brought her father out of hell and placed her in the heaven of the 33. And she told her father, you stay there and you have to keep practicing. You have to keep your sila and meditate, otherwise you may fall again. To us, that is very hard to believe. Even the Buddha cannot bring somebody out of hell. So the only explanation I can give is that it's the working of the mind. So if you are not focused on your body, you are not in the here and now, the mind can start going here, going there.
Pante, jhana is a bit difficult to understand. Can Pante say more about it, like how this samatha can bring to jhana state?
Samatha literally means tranquilization of the mind, making the mind more and more calm. For example, anapanasati. There are five jhana factors in the first jhana. So we use two, vitaka and vichara, thought directed and thought sustained. So we sit down and we pay attention to our breath. Breath goes in, goes out. Later books like the Visuddhimagga, they tell you to focus at one point, on the tip of your nose, or you're on your upper lip. But the Buddha never said that. The Buddha said, to know whether your breath is long or short. The Buddha also mentioned to be aware of the body. Most people, last time I also thought it was aware of the breath body. Now I think it's not only the breath body, also the physical body. So as we pay attention to our breathing, after some time, the tendency of the mind is to run away, to think of something. So we pull it back. When you pull it back, you are using vitaka as thought directed on your object, which is your breathing. And then you keep it on the breath that is sustaining your attention on the breath, that is vichara, thought sustained. So you sustain it on your breath. It runs away, you pull it back again using vitakka. And keeping it on your breath is vichara. So you just use these two things. And if you have the good karma, you are able to follow it longer and longer. But the problem with most people is that two hindrances will hinder you. One is restlessness. Your mind starts running here, running there and all that. That is very common. The other one is sloth and torpor. Because of sloth and torpor, you cannot observe your breath. Well, it's like there's a brick wall in front of you, you cannot see behind. You don't mind, you cannot listen to Dhamma holding your knees like that. You can do like me, put your leg one side. So we use only these two, and your karma is good. You can follow the breath longer and longer. If you can follow your breath longer and longer, slowly the mind becomes one-pointed. So as your mind becomes one-pointed, the other two jhana factors will arise, piti and sukha, delight and bliss. You're delighted that you are getting more and more peaceful. Sukha is the bliss. You feel a deep bliss inside you. Later books like the Visuddhimagga, they talk about piti as they call it rapture, and then they describe five types of piti. But in the suttas, the Buddha said, piti and sukha are subtle. Very subtle. And it's because your mind is very strong. Delight and bliss, your mind is so strong that they cannot become, these feelings cannot become strong. So you have to master that jhana. Once you attain these five factors, as you become stronger and quite noticeable, you have entered the first jhana. But the problem is, because jhana is another realm, a supramundane state, it's very easy to fall out of it. You can enter it for a short while, you're delighted, immediately you're too delighted, too happy. And then after that, you want to keep thinking, want to get it, because of your desire, your mind is not calm enough, you cannot get it. So that desire becomes an obstruction. So, like they say, you have to play it cool. Then only your mind can cool down. So that's the way. If you attain these five factors, you attain the first jhana. Only thing is you have to make it stronger.
For satipatthana, is it? Cultivate that also can lead to jhana.
Satipatthana basically is mindfulness on one object. As you are mindful of your breath, then the other four conditions you also be mindful. But you must put your attention on one. But in sati, you can observe all four in everyday life. But in satipatthana, because the sutta says if you practice satipatthana correctly, you must attain samadhi. That's why it's mentioned unremitting mindfulness.
The one is seems jale kam siu le, seems kam siu xiao ga jale hua le.
You listen to the suttas. I brought another 48 units of SD card players. And you can get a free SD card.
All right. Any other questions or queries? I think it's a good opportunity to ask if you have any doubts. Yeah, please.
Use the mic.
Bhante, will we know whether we attain first jhana or how do we know that? And yes, sometimes we just imagine it.
Yes, I mentioned the five jhana factors. And of course, some people, when your mind slowly becomes one-pointed, you are going in that direction of getting the first jhana. No? But you got to be stable, then you are sure you have.
Sure.
Bhante, all our practice every day, it's momentary. Jhana also momentary. How can you advise us at the last moment of death, how do we make use of this training so that we do not fall into the woeful planes? Thank you.
If you do want to fall into the woeful planes, as I mentioned last week, it's very important that you get right view. And to get right view, you have to listen to the true Dhamma, meaning the five Nikayas, and pay close attention. When you listen, then you understand. You see impermanence. When you see impermanence, as just now the sutta says, you will practice seclusion. You will move away from society. That's the only way. Of course, if you get concentration, it helps to calm your mind. So when a person is dying, his mind is not so agitated.
Okay.
The other thing I'd like to say is the other day I mentioned the stock formula for stream entry. And I quoted the sutta about Siha, the general. When the Buddha saw that Siha's mind was calm and rid of the five hindrances, then the Buddha explained the four Aryan truths to Siha, the general. And sitting there, the Buddha said he saw the Dhamma, he understood the Dhamma, he fathomed the Dhamma. This is the knowing and seeing that brings that person. This understanding of the Dhamma makes that person attain that right view, attain that first path. So sometimes people like to talk about personal experience. This is the personal experience. I quoted another sutta where the arahants were discussing, and one arahant asked another arahant. He's not sure, maybe he was not sure whether the other guy was an arahant. He said, friend Musila, besides various conditions, what was it? Besides. Something like apart from hearing from somebody, apart from maybe like nowadays you say, apart from book knowledge and all that, do you personally know the 12 conditions? And then he listed out the 12 conditions of dependent origination. And then this arahant said, apart from all these conditions, I personally know, I personally see these 12 conditions. So what he's saying is that he understands the 12 conditions himself, just like that stream entry, stock formula. So you can see this in the Vinaya books. When the Buddha preached to those even ascetics, the external sect ascetics, who had attained the four jhanas, their mind was so clear that when the Buddha explained the four noble truths, they understood. And immediately they became arahants. This is a direct experience. Understanding and seeing. Understanding means knowing and seeing. It's not seeing with your eye. It's not seeing with your flesh eye. It's not seeing with your heavenly eye. It's the understanding, seeing with the eye of wisdom that will make you attain the paths and the fruits. So for the first path and the first fruit, as long as you are able to concentrate your mind while listening to the suttas, concentrate long enough to understand the suttas, you can attain stream entry.
Okay.
But if you want higher levels, you need a clearer mind. So for the second path upwards, second fruit, third path, third fruit, and fourth path, fourth fruit, you need the jhanas. When you attain the jhanas, the mind becomes so clear, and when you listen, you can understand. So the levels of attainment depends on how clear your mind is, and that refers to the jhanas, because the higher jhana you attain, the lower your hindrance.
All right, any other queries? Oh, at the back.
Please. Maybe you can share with us Monday's understanding on White Lotus Sutta.
Of what?
White Lotus Sutta.
Oh, about the can you tell me a bit more? I forgot.
I also don't know very clear on this sutta. Maybe I will check it out and discuss with Bande later.
If you listen to my Nikaya talks, I have discussed that. So you look up the Vishnikaya, Vishutta, and then you refer to my Nikaya talks. I have explained. Sometimes it's the same with the Susima Sutta. People like to use the Susima Sutta to say that the Arhana does not need any jhana. That's not true. Because in the Susima Sutta, external ascetic became a monk to come and learn how our Buddha's disciples attain arhanhood, how they attain psychic powers and all that. So when he heard that some monks proclaimed that they had attained arhanhood, he went to them and asked them, Bhante, so since you have become enlightened, surely you have the heavenly eye? And they said, no. Surely you have the heavenly ear? They said, no. Surely you can read the minds of other people? They said, no. Surely you have the various psychic powers? You are able to walk through the wall, dive into the earth like water and come out, fly like a bird, etc. And they said, no. So all these psychic powers, he asked them, they said, no. Then after that, he asked them, surely you must have attained the Arupa Jhanas. And they said, no. Then he said, how come? Then they told him, we are liberated by wisdom. So when he went to ask the Buddha said, whether you know or not, first, there is unshakable knowledge of the Dhamma. In other words, you understand the Dhamma, you have unshakable faith in the Dhamma, in other words, you have attained stream entry, Sotapanna. Then after that, the Buddha said, comes knowledge of Nibbana, that means Arahanthood. Then the Buddha explained the various Dhammas to him, and made him see the various Dhammas. And then after that, after he had understood, the Buddha asked him, surely you have the heavenly eye? He said, I don't have. Surely have you, you have the heavenly ear? He said, no. All the various psychic powers, he said, no. Then the Buddha asked him, surely you must have the Arupa Jhana? He said, no. So the Buddha made him see that understanding of the Dhamma does not depend on your psychic powers, on your Arupa Jhanas. But the Arahants never said that they don't have the four jhanas. According to other suttas, they must have the four jhanas. The problem is later monks, because they belittle the jhanas, then they say, they infer that these monks liberated by wisdom don't have the four jhanas. But it's never mentioned they don't have the four jhanas. It's only mentioned they don't have the four arupas. Unfortunately, later books, even like the Agama Sutras are also distorted, because Agama Sutras are not like Pali Sutras. Pali Sutras were preserved from Emperor Asoka's time down to us, you know. Mahayana, when they started, at first they accept Theravada teachings. Later, they look down on Theravada teachings, call it Hinayana. And the Bodhisattva precepts, which I have taken before, one of the precepts is that you cannot study Hinayana books. So about 300 years after Mahayana started, they start to accept Theravada teachings. And Theravada start to accept Mahayana teachings. And they started to accept paramis and all that. That's why we have 10 paramis in Theravada also. But that's not really Theravada. When they started to accept our Pali Suttas, they found that they did not have the Pali Suttas because they had already lost them. Then they started to collect back the Pali Suttas from different sources. And the Agama Sutras is about half of our Pali Suttas. And some of the sutras in the Agama Sutras are anjing, is distorted. For example, in the Susima Sutta, in our Pali Suttas, in the Susima Sutta, the Arahant said they had not attained psychic powers, they had not attained the Arupas, that's all. In the Agama Sutra version, the Arahant said they had not attained psychic powers, had not attained Arupas, had not attained the four jhanas. This is a distortion of the Sutta. That's why Agama Sutras are not reliable, not like our Pali Sutras. Even the great scholar Akira Hirakawa, the late professor of Tokyo University, he was a world authority on the history of Buddhism. He studied Mahayana, studied Theravada, and he agrees that the most reliable source of the Buddha's words are in the Pali Sutras, not in the Mahayana. So you have to be very careful. Later books, they distort the teachings. For example, just now I said, the Bodhisattva path is very clearly stated by the Buddha, and yet the Pure Land say the Buddha recited Amitabha Buddha. And then the Mahayana mainstream say he cultivated the paramis. And then some monks say he practiced Vipassana meditation. All this is not what the sutta say.